بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
السلام عليكم ورحمة
الله. I welcome you to the final session on the discussion of tawakkul, reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're going to be dwelling on some of the stories of the prophets and some of the stories of the Salaf, which can be examples for us to follow in our lives. We can set to what degree we would like to put our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on these stories. But before we get into the stories themselves, let me remind you that the station of tawakkul consists of three substations within tawakkul. And you cannot have full tawakkul unless you have all three elements within tawakkul. The first one is at-tafwid or at-taslim, in which you submit all your affairs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You submit the affairs of dunya and the affairs of akhirah. And you feel totally trusting that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is taking care of things in the best possible manner. That's what taslim is. Having developed confidence in that sense, the second station is to make sure that you have isti'ana. Because the second substation within the station of tawakkul is isti'ana, in which you will do whatever is in your hand. You know, whatever is possible to you, the efforts, the endeavors that you can, you will put that in action and then leave it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from that point onwards. So al-isti'ana is the second thing you should do while you are engaged in the action itself. After you have done what you could possibly do, comes the third station of tawakkul, which is al-rida, to be pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be pleased and content with whatever comes from Allah. Not necessarily what you desire, no, whatever comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a person who masters these three areas, they will be always happy, energetic, optimistic, cheerful, and they will have a pleasant life in this dunya and in the hereafter. So when we relate the stories of the prophets and the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, let's try to establish which of the three stations of tawakkul is more prominent in the story. To begin with, let's take the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that we have the best of example in Ibrahim and those who believed with Ibrahim alayhi salam. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Mumtahina, chapter 60, verse 4, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. You have the best of example in فِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهُ. In Ibrahim and those who followed Ibrahim alayhi salam. And then at the end of the very same ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that part of their dua, which is one dua I hope that you will capture and you will always repeat in the salat or in your dua concerning tawakkul. Because every time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relates a particular dua that was said by the prophets or the pious people before us, the only reason why he says that is for us to adopt it and take it into our lives. Their dua is رَبَّنَا عَلَيْكَ تَوَكَّلْنَا وَإِلَيْكَ أَنَبْنَا وَإِلَيْكَ الْمَصِيرُ. رَبَّنَا عَلَيْكَ تَوَكَّلْنَا وَإِلَيْكَ أَنَبْنَا وَإِلَيْكَ الْمَصِيرُ. We've understood how important tawakkul is, and we've also understood that nothing can be achieved without the assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you need to ask Allah for tawakkul. What's the best dua to ask Allah for tawakkul? This is the dua of Ibrahim and those who believed with him. What did they say? رَبَّنَا, our Lord, عَلَيْكَ تَوَكَّلْنَا. Upon you, we put our trust. We trust you on all of our affairs. وَإِلَيْكَ أَنَبْنَا. إِلَيْكَ أَنَبْنَا means to you we return. Al-inaba means return. Tawbah also means return. Tawbah means to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inaba also means to return, but inaba means we return with eagerness to do more good. So if you only repent from the sin and come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, deciding never to sin again, this will be called tawbah. Whereas if you have inaba to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will repent from the sin and you have determination to replace the sin with something good. So having that eagerness in your mind, this will be called inaba. So they said, Rabbana alayka tawakkalna, our Lord, upon you we put our trust. Wa ilayka anabna, and to you we return with repentance and with eagerness to worship you. Wa ilayka al-masir, and to you we shall return for reward. Meaning that you are anticipating that you will go through hardships. And these hardships are not going to be rewarded only in this dunya, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you meet Him, when you have the return to Him, He will give you all the rewards you want. So this dua, repeat it, memorize it. رَبَّنَا عَلَيْكَ تَوَكَّلْنَا وَإِلَيْكَ أَنَبْنَا وَإِلَيْكَ الْمَصِيرُ. رَبَّنَا عَلَيْكَ تَوَكَّلْنَا وَإِلَيْكَ أَنَبْنَا وَإِلَيْكَ الْمَصِيرُ. Ibrahim alayhi salam gave da'wah to his people who were upon polytheism, shirk. They worshipped idols and statues, and they see in them, in the idols, representations of the stars. They used to believe that the world is governed by stars, and every star in the skies, in the heaven, is represented by an idol. So they will take a stone and they will shape it in a human shape, and they will say, this is a representation for this star, and they would worship them beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They had many stars. So Ibrahim alayhi salam came to them, argued with them, debated with them rationally, logically, and he said, Allah, the one who created you, which you acknowledge to that. You say Allah is the one who created you. And you say that these idols cannot create anything. Yet you insist on worshipping idols beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he spoke to them in a logical sense, but that didn't work. And then Ibrahim alayhi salam, because of this, he thought that he need to teach them a lesson that might intrigue them to think. So when they went out for one of their festivals, they had like a gathering or a celebration that they hold in annual basis. So when they went out for that festive, he said, لَأَكِيدَنَّ أَصْنَامَكُمْ, I have a plan for your idols. So when they went away, he destroyed all the idols with an axe, and he left the axe on the shoulder of the big one amongst them, the biggest idol. He left the axe on his shoulder. So when they came back, they were shocked. They said, مَنْ فَعَلَ هَذَا بِآلِهَتِنَا, who did this to our idols? They said, سَمِعْنَا فَتًا يَذْكُرُهُمْ يُقَالُ لَهُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ, we hear of a young boy who constantly cusses and curses them and talks down to them. It must be him. He is the only one. When they came to Ibrahim alayhi salam, he said to them, do you worship that which you make with your own hands? Think about it. He said to them, do you worship something that cannot even defend itself? Think about it. So that made them think. That actually made them think. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala records this by saying, فَرَجَعُوا إِلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ فَقَالُوا إِنَّكُمْ أَنْتُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. They said to themselves, really, we are the ones on the wrong here. They acknowledged that. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, because of their pride and arrogant, He says, ثُمَّ نُكِسُوا عَلَىٰ رُؤُسِهِمْ, then they changed their minds. They returned back to their old ways because of the arrogance in their hearts. ثُمَّ نُكِسُوا عَلَىٰ رُؤُسِهِمْ, they started to argue. They said, لَقَدْ عَلِمْتَ مَا هَؤُلَاءِ يَنْطِقُونَ. They said to him, you know Ibrahim, that these idols don't speak. He said to them, even that, can you not reflect on that? The fact that you are worshipping something that cannot even speak. They cannot even respond to you. And then they decided that they will burn Ibrahim alayhi salam. They said, Unsuru alihatakum, you have to stick up and defend your idols and its honor by burning Ibrahim. So what they did, they dug a hole in a valley, a huge hole, and they kept on collecting wood for that hole for months. Imam Suddi, he says, the collection of the wood continued for months, so much so that a lady amongst them would be sick, and she would vow, she will take an oath, saying that if Allah cures me, I will take part in the collection of food. So everybody was taking part in that. So they collected lots of food, and when the time came to throw Ibrahim at it, they set up a huge fire, so huge that they couldn't actually go and throw Ibrahim in it. They had to throw him with the catapult. If you know what the catapult is, it's an instrument they use in war to throw fireballs towards the enemy. They used to use it back in the days. So they put Ibrahim alayhi salam on that catapult and they threw him in the fire. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said, when Ibrahim alayhi salam was being thrown towards the fire, he said, Hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakeel. Sufficient for me is Allah. Hasbi Allah. Meaning that He is my agent, He is the one looking after my affairs, He is my wakeel. And he says, wa ni'mal wakeel. He is the best wakeel. He is the best agent that is looking after my affair. Even in these circumstances. Even in these circumstances, he's being thrown in the fire. You know, somebody else would have given up. Before that, long before that, he said, where is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when they held me? They held Ibrahim alayhi salam for months. While they are collecting the wood and setting up the fire, they held him for months. So he could have said, where is Allah from this? If Allah was with me, he would have supported me in this. But he stayed faithful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that Allah is looking after his affairs some way that he is not knowledgeable of. So when he was being thrown, he said, Hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakeel. What was the result? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلْنَا يَا نَارُ كُونِي بَرْدًا وَسَلَامًا عَلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمِ. We said to the fire, كُونِي بَرْدًا, become a source of coolness, وَسَلَامًا, and peace to Ibrahim alayhi salam. Scholars, they said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made sure that he command the fire to be both cold and a source of peace. Otherwise, Ibrahim alayhi salam would have been extremely cold in the fire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كُونِي بَرْدًا وَسَلَامًا, become a source of coolness, cold, and also a source of peace. Some scholars, they took this overboard a little bit, and they said that Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he was being thrown, Jibreel alayhi salam came to him. Okay, and they said that Jibreel alayhi salam, he said, Ibrahim alayhi salam, alaka haja, do you have a need that I can fulfill for you? Ibrahim alayhi salam said, amma minka fala, as from you, I don't need anything. But from Allah, as for Allah, he said, ilmuhu bihali yughni an du'ai. عِلْمُهُ بِحَالِي يُغْنِي عَنْ دُعَائِي. His knowledge of my affairs is sufficient that I don't even need to make dua to him. But this is not authentic. This part of the story is not authentic. Ibrahim alayhi salam didn't say that. He actually made a dua. When you say حَسْبِيَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ, this is a dua. So you can't say that Allah knows my affairs, so I'm not going to make dua. No. Despite your knowledge of his knowledge of your states and affairs, you should make the dua. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he did make the dua. And the best dua you could make in this sort of circumstances, to say, Hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakeel. Very strong dua. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned the fire into peace and coolness for Ibrahim alayhi salam. Also when he left his town, Ibrahim alayhi salam was born and brought up in Iraq. When he left the town of his childhood, where his family and friends are, he said, إِنِّي ذَاهِبٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّي. In the other ayah, إِنِّي مُهَاجِرٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّي. I am migrating towards my Lord. Okay? He doesn't know where exactly he's going to go. Leaving the city, which is the only place that you know, and the only place where you have your childhood memories, leaving your family and friends, everything behind your back. And leaving to where? He says, إِنِّي مُهَاجِرٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّي سَيَهْدِينَ. Allah is going to guide me. The one who created me, الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي, ويهدين. The one who created me is going to guide me. Look at this confidence. This confidence in itself makes Ibrahim do something very strange. Leaving your own country, leaving your own home. You know, these days, subhanAllah, many people, if they want to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and change their ways, the first obstacle they find is what? Is change company. If you don't have trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, decisions like these, they can be very difficult. How could you change company? The people who you have known for your childhood and adolescence and your adulthood, many years you've known them, but they are evil company. Is it easy to get rid of them? Many people, they struggle in that obstacle. With tawakkul, Ibrahim alayhi salam was able to abandon everything. He said, إِنِّي مُهَاجِرٌ, I am migrating. And he did not mention a city or a destination. He said, إِلَىٰ رَبِّي, I am going to my Lord. He went to Sham, Palestine, and he settled there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him with Ishaq and Ya'qub, and he established the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in there. The second story of today's session is the story of Musa alayhi salam. Musa alayhi salam was sent to the children of Israel as a messenger, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him to Fir'aun with miracles, 9 miracles, 9 ayat. He told Fir'aun, all I want from you is to let the children of Israel come with me. Do not humiliate them. لا تعذبهم. Send them with me and I'm taking them back to Jerusalem so they can settle there. And that's where they come from, the children of Israel. Fir'aun alayhi la'atullah, he refused. And he challenged Musa alayhi salam. Musa alayhi salam showed him the miracles that he has. So Fir'aun gathered the magicians. They challenged Musa alayhi salam. Musa alayhi salam won the challenge. And his miracle overcome the magic of the magicians. The magicians themselves believed in him. The people believed in Musa alayhi salam. Fir'aun was infuriated. He was extremely angry. And he decided that he's going to assassinate them. He's going to kill them all. He said, إِنَّهُمْ لَشِرْذِمَةٌ قَلِيلُونَ وَإِنَّهُمْ لَنَا لَغَائِضُونَ. They are very few in number and we are very angry towards them. Let's kill them all. When they knew about this, Musa alayhi salam told the children of Israel to get together and run away towards the sea, the Red Sea, so that they can cross from one side to the other. They ran, and then when they got to that place in the shore, they got to a place where khalas, that's it. The ocean is in front of them, the water is in front of them, they couldn't take it any further. And Fir'aun with his army are behind their backs. They said, Inna lamudrakun. It's inevitable. We are going to be captured. We are going to be destroyed and killed. Musa alayhi salam was promised. He was promised that the blessed land, the land of Al-Aqsa, is going to be their land. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to them, يعني أدخل الأرض المقدسة التي كتب الله لكم. Go to the land, the blessed land, which Allah has decreed to be for you. So if you have this in mind, if Allah promised that you will have that, why should you doubt? Why should you panic in this situation? So they panicked. They said, we were going to be killed. Musa alayhi salam said, كلا. Never. كلا إن معي ربي سيهدين. Allah is with me. And some way, somehow, he's going to find me an exit from this situation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately, he said, فَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْهِ أَنِضْرِبْ بِعَصَاكَ الْحَجَرِ. We revealed to Musa alayhi salam that he should hit the ocean or the water with your stick. فَانْفَلَقَ كُلُّ فِرْقٍ كَالطَّوْدِ الْعَظِيمِ. And then it split into many parts, but there was a part for the children of Israel, 12 parts for them, and they passed through them. And then when Fir'aun came, Allah drowned them all. So you look at the situation of Musa alayhi salam. Even in the most difficult of situations, you really cannot see an exit out for you. But that faith in you, the faith that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to keep his promise to you, that is going to give you steadfastness. It's going to make you feel like you can continue and Allah will never let you down. When Musa alayhi salam felt like this and had that faith and he said those words, Allah never let him down. طيب. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the hadith, أنا عند ظن عبدي بي فليظن بي ما شاء. I will be to my servant how he thinks for me. If you are in the middle of the situation, you think about the worst case scenario and you get so stressed and you become so gloomy because of that, then whatever you thought about is going to materialize. You will have the worst case scenario. So this idea of the worst case scenario is not always the best way to think. Okay? Always hope for the best. Because thinking about the worst case scenario can paralyze your thoughts. You will not be able to think clearly and you will think with despair, and therefore you're not going to come up with any solutions. But if you have hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with me and he is going to find me a solution, even from a practical, psychological point of view, you are better off thinking like this. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on top of that, because you are thinking like this, he will find you an opening and he will give you some solution. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the third story of today's session, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam himself, when he was first sent and he was by himself, and he was defying the whole society, the whole town, the whole clan of Quraysh. He was defying all of them. He said to them, قولوا لا إله إلا الله تفلحوا. Say لا إله إلا الله and you will be successful. But that wasn't the best thing they wanted to hear, because they know what this entails. They have pride. They know that this will mean that they will be equal to everybody in the tribe. They know that they have this leadership status and they don't want to let go of that. And they also knew that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going to be on top of them if they follow him. So they refused to follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The narrator says that I have seen them, the chiefs of Mecca, throwing stones at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the souq of Uqaq. When the Arabs, they come to Mecca to trade, Abu Lahab himself, Abdul Uzza, Abu Lahab himself, he would throw him with stones and he would say he's a crazy man, don't believe him. What did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one time he was humiliated and accused of so many things until he bled from his heel and his ankles. A little girl, his daughter Zainab alayhi salam, she came to him with a cup of water after they have hassled him a lot, and she gave it to the Prophet ﷺ and he washed his face. He said to her, Ya Bunayya, La takhshay ala abiki ghilatan wala dilla. O my daughter, do not fear for your dad any conspiracy, any plotting, any deception from his enemies, and he will not be humiliated. See, in the time where it looks like he is being humiliated, but because he knows he's with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, my daughter, I am not going to be let down. So that faith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had in his mind, that he is appointed by Allah and he is working for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gave him that energy. Even when he's being hassled and harassed, he can see the light at the end of the tunnel. Another situation is the trust of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the battle of the trench. You know that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated to Medina, the believers settled and many people came into Islam, and the Qurayshis, they started to realize that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is getting stronger by the day. And they thought, unless we do something now, he will become too strong that we will not be able to control him. So what they did, they had what they called the federation, Al-Ahzab. And they agreed with many tribes around Medina. They collected an army of 10,000 people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls them in the Quran, Al-Ahzab. And there is a surah in the Quran by the name Al-Ahzab. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those Ahzab came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the believers saw Al-Ahzab, the huge number of Al-Ahzab, it was a great test for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, هُنَالِكَ ابْتُلِيَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَزُلْزِلُوا زِلْزَالًا شَدِيدًا. Thereupon, the believers were tested severely and they were shaken very hard. So much so that the believers were split into two groups. One group who stood fast and they still believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and had faith. And another group, the hypocrites, what did they say? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ يَقُولُ الْمُنَافِقُونَ وَالَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ مَا وَعَدَنَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ إِلَّا غُرُورًا. The hypocrites and those who have sickness in their hearts, what did they say in the time of tribulation? They said, Allah and His Messenger only promised us delusion, empty promises. And what they are referring to here when they say empty promises, Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu, he suggested to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when you are facing a big army like this, what we use in Persia, we use the strategy of digging a trench around our city. This is a technique that was new to them. So basically they dug the trench, they made it deep enough that the army will not be able to cross. But while they were digging, there was a huge rock they couldn't break through. No matter how much power and how many people tried, they couldn't. So they called the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu took the axe and he said, Bismillah, and he hit that big rock with his axe and it cracked and it split into two parts. And the Prophet sallallahu, he said, Allahu Akbar. With the spark that came out of that hit, he said, I could see the palaces of Al-Madain of Persia. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is promising me that Islam is going to reach Persia. He does it one more time. And he said, Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing me Al-Yaman. I am going to have Al-Yaman. Islam is going to reach Al-Yaman. And look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving the Muslims glad tidings when they need it most. And then again the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he hit the third time which broke the rock. He said, I can see the Byzantine Empire being under my control. So Kisra, Qaisar and Al-Yaman, all their kingdom will come into Islam and into the fold of Islam. So this was the promise. The hypocrites referring to this promise, when they saw the confederation, they say, yeah, the Prophet ﷺ is promising us that we're going to conquer Persia, Byzantine and Yemen. And look at us now, we are stuck in Medina. Right? So because they don't have trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when they are shaken a little bit, they completely forget about the promise of Allah. But the believers, what did they say when they saw what they saw? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, He says, as for the believers, وَلَمَّا رَأَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الْأَحْزَابِ قَالُوا هَذَا مَا وَعَدَنَا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَصَدَقَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَمَا زَادَهُمْ إِلَّا إِيمَانًا وَتَسْلِيمًا. Chapter 33, verse 22, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when the believers saw the confederation, they said, this is what Allah and His Messenger promised us. So basically they're saying that this is victory coming. So they see the tribulation itself as victory. Look at the optimism. They say, this is the promise of Allah. Victory is coming. We are making our way towards what? towards the conquest of Persia, the Byzantine, and Yemen. This is our way towards it. So look, because they have iman and they believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's why they said, وَصَدَقَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ, and Allah and His Messenger said the truth. Whatever they promised is gonna come. وَمَا زَادَهُمْ إِلَّا إِيمَانًا, when they saw the tribulation, that only increased them in faith. Faith in whom? In Allah. So a true believer, no matter what the odds are, you will still have faith that what Allah promised me is gonna happen. What Allah has promised me is going to happen. وَتَسْلِيمًا, they increased in what? In their taslim. Remember, the first stage or the first station within tawakkul is what? At-taslim. When you have tafweel, you give it to Allah. So that only caused them to become what? More submissive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they became even more calm. You know, that's what confidence and trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala produces in your life. So this is what happened to the Sahaba radhiyallahu anhum. With the tawakkul, they differed from the hypocrites. And this might be mapped to our lives, my brothers and sisters, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did tell us in the Quran that some of the Muslims, they may not have the hypocrisy of i'tiqad, meaning they are not hypocrites in terms of the belief they have within their hearts. No. Within their hearts, they believe on Allah and His Messenger, but they have aspects of hypocrisy. They have aspects of hypocrisy. The hypocrisy in the Prophet, they have nifaq i'tiqadi, whereby they hide this belief within them, but outwardly they show Islam. This is called hypocrisy that is related to creed. Nifaq al-i'tiqad. But Muslims, can Muslims be hypocrites? Yes. How can they be hypocrites? They can be hypocrites in the sense that within them they will have Islam, but outwardly they don't reflect their iman. So hypocrisy is when the inner self of the person differs from the outer self of the person. With regards to the munafiqeen, who are disbelievers, they hide kufr and they show Islam. Whereas a Muslim can be the other way around. He can have iman within his heart, but his actions are not matching. So these are aspects of nifaq. The Muslim cannot be called munafiq. You can say that this is khisla min khisal al-nifaq. You have an attribute or characteristics of nifaq, but you don't call the Muslim munafiq. Does that make sense? يعني فيك خصلة من النفاق ثلاث من كن فيه كان منافقا خالصا. Whoever has these three qualities, he will become a pure hypocrite. And whoever has one of them, he will have one aspect of hypocrisy. So in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us this is the situation of the hypocrites, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also tells us that some of the Muslims might have circumstances that match or that looks like the hypocrites. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, in Surah Al-Hajj, chapter 22, verse 11, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَى حَرْفٍ. Amongst people, there are some who would only worship Allah on the verge, not established on the deen, but on the verge. And they will be looking, I am going to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let me see what I get in return. If I get something good, they stay on the deen. If they don't get something good in their lives, they reject the deen. They will say, this deen has no good in it. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَى حَرْفٍ فَإِنْ أَصَابَهُ خَيْرٌ اطْمَأَنَّ بِهِ. If he is blessed with something good, he will be settled and he will stay on the deen. وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ فِتْنَةٌ, and if he is afflicted by a trial or a tribulation, what will happen? انقلب على وجهه. He will return back and he will leave the deen behind him. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, خَسِرَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. By doing this, he will lose not only al-akhirah, both. خَسِرَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. He will lose his dunya and he will lose also his akhirah. A person who have tawakkul in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will not have this attitude towards Allah. They will say, we worship Allah no matter what. Whether I am rich or poor, whether I am healthy or sick, whether I am blessed with family or a bachelor, whatever the situation is, I am still content because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like we said, tawakkul, we trust Him that He has your interest in mind. He protects your interest, not anybody else's. So because of this trust, you still see in these circumstances that they are better for you than what you think of yourself. Ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my brothers and sisters, is one of the major concerns for the believer. You know, one thing that really stresses you, if the shaitan, and I have come across a brother whose life has become like hell, because the shaitan keeps on telling him, you are on your way to hell, you are on your way to hell, you are on your way to hell, you are. It's a very daunting idea. If the shaitan can make you see that your life going towards destruction, what's going to happen? You will despair, and if you despair, you will give up. And you will not do anything. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, don't despair. لا تيأسوا من روح الله. Do not despair of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only the disbelievers give up on the mercy of Allah. But believers always believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now when you see that you have sins in your life, you have negligence towards your deen in some aspects of your life, don't let that lead you to believe in that you are doomed and destroyed. No. Believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to look after you. You know, as a Muslim, if I ask you who is providing for you, what would you say?
Allah.
So you will believe that Allah is the one providing you throughout, and you will also believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide you for you from the future. Now the question, would Allah as a Muslim provide you with food and neglect you with much more important matters, spiritual food? Would He do that to you? No, He will not do that. Allah promised in the Quran, He says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُدْخِلُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. Truly, Allah, in the present tense, He used the verb in the present tense, يُدْخِلُ. He is currently in the process of admitting the believers into Jannah. So right now, as we speak, Allah is doing this for us. One way or another. So even when you have committed a sin, you need to see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed that sin to happen to you. He had let you commit that sin because He knows that committing that sin is beneficial to you, provided you take a lesson from it. Provided you take a lesson from it. And with this light, you will be peaceful. Because as a believer, what is most important for you, dunya or akhirah? Akhirah. If you think that your akhirah is doomed, can you become happy? You would be very stressed. And I know a person whose life has become like hell, simply because the shaitan made him feel that you can't do it to Jannah. You cannot do it to heaven. Considering your actions, you can't make it to Jannah. So again, if you consider only your actions, obviously you will give up. But if you say, no, Allah waliyu alladhina amanu yukhrijuhum min al-dhulumati ila an-nur. Allah is the friend and the protector and the sustainer, al-wali. And He is close to those who are believers. What does He do? He takes them out of darkness into light. يُخْرِجُهُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. Do you believe in this? He is currently doing this. So believing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised that the minute you say La ilaha illallah, He's taking it upon His shoulder. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is responsible for admitting you to Jannah. He's going to get you to Jannah one way or another. طيب? Either by guiding you, either by giving you knowledge, either by helping you repent, or by sending you trials. But one way or another, Allah is going to make sure that you go to Jannah. Simply because you said what? La ilaha illallah. Whoever says La ilaha illallah, Allah will take them to Jannah. One way or another. And look at subhanAllah, believing like this and feeling like that, how much peace would you have in your life? You'll feel very confident. Alhamdulillah, I am in safe hands. I just need to do what Allah has told me. What Allah says, I'm going to follow it. And I am sure I am not going to be solely dependent on my own efforts. Allah is there. He's guiding my steps. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَعْبُدْهُ وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَيْهِ. In Surah Hud, verse 23, Surah Hud, He said, فَعْبُدْهُ وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَيْهِ. Worship Allah and put your trust in Him. So even in the worship of Allah, can you do it without Him? No. Put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Surah Al-Ahzab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, chapter 33, verses 2 and 3, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اِتَّبِعْ مَا يُوحَى إِلَيْكَ مِنْ رَبِّكَ. Follow that which is revealed to you from your Lord. Obviously, this is a commandment to the Prophet ﷺ, and it passes on to us. So every one of us is being told, follow what is revealed to you from your Lord. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرًا. Allah with all your affairs very acquainted and very knowledgeable. And then in the following ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Put your trust in Allah. So even following the revelation is not easy unless you have your trust on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you're going to rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in one aspect of your life, let it be first and foremost, the deen. Know that the deen is not something that you can do on your own. Become cheerful. Allah is taking care of things. All you have to do is follow His instructions. And inshallah, one way or another, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take us to His mercy and to His Jannah. The fifth incident is the incident of Sulh al-Hudaybiyah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَإِن جَنَحُوا لِلسَّلْمِ فَجْنَحْ لَهَا وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. If instead of war, they prefer to have a treaty, they prefer to have a ceasefire, إِن جَنَحُوا لِلسَّلْمِ If they want to have peace, فَجْنَحْ لَهَا, go ahead with peace. Peace is better than war. But then he says, وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ, put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the context of Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, where the Prophet ﷺ was clearly oppressed and wronged by the chiefs of Mecca. When they returned him and the Sahaba who came to Mecca for Umrah, they were told to slaughter their animals, their sacrifice outside Mecca, and return back to Medina and only come back from the next year. And they laid some oppressive conditions upon the Prophet ﷺ, of which is a condition that says, if anybody comes as a Muslim from our part, from our tribe, you return them to us. But if any Muslim rejects your religion and comes back to us, we don't have to return them back to you. This sounded oppressive, but the Prophet said, no, I'm going to have my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And ultimately, this led to many good later on. From Sulh Hudaybiyah, many good came. The Prophet said, whoever is going to reject his deen, why would we want him back? And whoever is coming to us from them, we will return them to them, believing that Allah will find them a way out. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will find an exit for those people from his way. So they did that. And for a year or so, the believers who believed on the Prophet ﷺ from Mecca, they used to return them back. But instead of returning back, they used to kill the messenger who took them back to Quraysh. Halfway, they would kill them, and they collected themselves in the middle, in the path between Medina and Mecca. And they used to hijack the caravans and the business trades of Quraysh. So when this happens, Quraysh came to the Prophet ﷺ and he said to him, O Prophet of Allah, you know what? We allow you to break this part of the condition. Allow them to join you. Because they are destroying our caravans and our business. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided for them a way out. But also in the meantime, the Prophet ﷺ was at peace and he wasn't in war and he was able to speak. And this is all the Prophet ﷺ wanted. He wanted to speak. He wanted to be able to speak to people without them fearing for their lives. Because part of the treaty, that whoever wants to come to our side of the treatment, they can do so. And whoever wants to go into their side of the treatment, they can do so. And that was a victory for the Prophet ﷺ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِن جَنَحُوا لِلسَّلْمِ فَاجْنَحْ لَهَا وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. If they want to reconciliate, if they want to have a mutual agreement of peace, then go ahead with that. But put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why do you have to put your trust in Allah? Because most often, the conditions of any reconciliation is not going to sound just and fair from both parties. So for you to be able to go ahead with any agreement, you need to put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I see this very frequently. When I sit between couples who have problems, husbands and wives, and they sit, they have an agreement. The one problem they have with one another is trust. They don't trust each other. They feel that if I go ahead with this reconciliation agreement, this person is not going to fulfill me my right. This condition is maybe too oppressive for me. And therefore you'll find them, they try to reconciliate, but because they don't put their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they can't come to an agreement. But any agreement you come across, if you want to have it with people, you need to put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Believe in that your affairs are not going to be protected by the terms of the agreement. They are going to be protected by what? By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With this confidence, you will be able to have any agreement with people. Without this confidence, any terms of any agreement will sound very oppressive and you will not be able to engage on it. Story number 6, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was on his way back from one battlefield called Dhatul Riqa'. And he was with a group of the Sahaba, the army, and they decided to settle down in a valley. It was noon, very hot, so they decided everybody is going to take a rest. So they left the Prophet ﷺ under one tree and everybody looked for a tree for themselves. A Bedouin came to the Prophet ﷺ, he sneaked in and he found the sword of the Prophet ﷺ hanging on the tree. So he took the sword and he stood right on top of the Prophet ﷺ and he said, Ya Muhammad, ma yamna'uka minni liyawm. He says, Muhammad, what can protect you from me today? I'm holding your sword. You are weaponless basically. What are you going to do? He said, who's going to protect you? Prophet ﷺ said, Allah. The Bedouin said, again, who is going to protect you? The Prophet ﷺ very calmly, he said, Allah. This confidence, this calm, made the Arabi panic. He started to panic. And the third time he asked him the question, the Arabi, when he heard the answer for the third time, he dropped the sword, fell off his hand. And then the Prophet ﷺ called the Sahaba, and Jabir ibn Abdullah narrating the story, he said, we were totally heedless, resting, and we only heard when the Prophet ﷺ was calling us, and there was one man in his presence. He said, this is the man who stood by my head and he was saying such and such. So the confidence in the Prophet ﷺ's voice made the man panic, the Bedouin. He panicked when he felt how calm the Prophet ﷺ was. Another story also of the tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is something that we touched on the beginning part of it, the story of Al-Ghar, when the Prophet ﷺ migrated from Mecca to Medina. You know that he agreed with this man called Abdullah ibn Urayqit, and he followed all the normal causes for success and for him to be saved. And they hid in the cave, this cave called Ghar Hira. Because when the Prophet ﷺ and Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anh, they left Mecca, and the Quraysh, they found out, they set a prize. They said, there is 200 camels for anybody who comes back with the head of Muhammad. And 100 camels, whoever finds Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anh. So everybody was looking for them. Everybody wanted to have that prize. Many people, they set out between Mecca and Medina. Right? While they were looking for them, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anh and the Prophet sallam, they were in this cave for 3 days. He said, some people came and they were above our heads. And only if they looked down, they could see us. If they looked down, they would have been able to see us. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anh, he said, Ya Rasulullah, if one of them just looks down, they will see us, they will find out. The Prophet ﷺ very calmly, he said, Ya Abu Bakr, ma dhannuka bithnain Allahu thalithahuma. Abu Bakr, what are you thinking of the situation of two people, the third of whom is Allah? If Allah with you, what's going to happen to you? So this is the Prophet ﷺ, the same person who followed all the natural causes to be saved. He hid in the cave, he hired Abdullah ibn Urayqit, he had some sustenance with him. But when you've done everything you can do within your disposal, what you do? Just be confident. Allah is going to take care of things. إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ لَا تَحْزَنْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا. In Surah At-Tawbah, Allah says, relate to them when the Prophet ﷺ says to his companion, Abu Bakr, don't be stressed, Allah is with us. So this is what a Muslim should do. You do the part of al-isti'ana, and once you've done al-isti'ana, meaning you've followed the causes, then submit and expect nothing but good from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number 7 is the story of Khabbab ibn al-Arat. Khabbab ibn al-Arat was one of the poor amongst the Sahaba. They were tortured and humiliated and punished. They went through a lot of hardship in the time of Mecca. So Khabbab ibn al-Arat radiallahu anhu, he said, one time we came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he was sitting leaning his back to the Kaaba. And they said to him, O Prophet of Allah, أَمَا تَرَى مَا نَحْنُ فِيهِ أَلَا دَعَوْتَ اللَّهَ لَنَا. He said, Ya Rasulullah, can you not see what we are on? The kind of punishment, torture and prosecution. Should you not make dua for us? أَلَا تَسْتَنْصِرْ لَنَا أَلَا تَدْعُوا اللَّهَ لَنَا. The Prophet ﷺ, he could have easily made dua. But he wanted people to see that you shouldn't always expect Allah to give you what you want. You need to be confident that whatever Allah decrees for you is good. Because these Sahaba, they want the hardship to be relieved of them. They want to be relieved from this hardship. So the Prophet ﷺ wanted to teach them a lesson. Don't always expect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you exactly what you want. He said to them, كَانَ الرَّجُلُ فِي مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ. A man, a strong believer from the nations before you, he would be brought, يُحْفَرُ لَهُ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَيُجْعَلُ فِيهِ. A ditch will be dug for him on the soil, and he will be buried in that ditch, and he will be buried up to his neck. فَيُجَاءُ بِالْمِنْشَارِ فَيُوضَعُ عَلَى رَأْسِهِ. Only his head is still visible, and they would bring a saw, and they will sew his head into two parts. The Prophet ﷺ said, فَيُشَقُّ بِثْنَتَيْنِ وَمَا يَصُدُّهُ ذَلِكَ عَنْ دِينِهِ. His head, his skull will be split into two, and that will not make him change his religion. Meaning that if this would happen to the nations before us, Allah, was he looking after their affair? He was. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees for you to go through some torture, some pain, would you reject your religion and reject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a Lord, as a Rabb? No, still have faith in him. That this may be the best thing for you. وَيُمْشَطُ بِأَمْشَاطِ الْحَدِيدِ مَا دُونَ لَحْمِهِ مِنْ عَظْمٍ أَوْ عَصَبٍ وَمَا يَصُدُّهُ ذَلِكَ عَنْ دِينِ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهِ لَيُتِمَّنَّ اللَّهُ هَذَا الْأَمْرِ حَتَّى يَسِيرَ الرَّاكِبُ مِنْ صَنْعَاءِ إِلَى حَضْرَمَوْتِ لَا يَخَافُ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَالذِّئْبَ عَلَى غَنَمِهِ. He said, by Allah, Allah will perfectly complete this religion. He will establish it on this earth. So much so that the earth will be so peaceful that a traveler from Sana'a to Hadramaut, this is the most hazardful region to travel from Sana'a, and Hadramaut is full of thieves and gangs on the way. He said, it will be so peaceful that a man will travel from Sana'a to Hadramaut and he will fear nothing but Allah and perhaps the wolf for his sheep. But other than that, because of Islam being spread, peace will also be spread. The point of this hadith is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes might decree that it is best for you to go through hardships. Obviously, He will only decree for you the type of hardships that are suitable for your level of iman. You need to establish this as well. Because sometimes people, when they hit with a calamity, they give up quickly. And they say, I can't do this. I can't do this. I can't cope with this. I can't cope with this. And with this attitude, they will fail. But if you have the belief that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send me trials and I will have hardships in my life, but every hardship that I go through is something that I can cope with. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will only send to me something that is reasonable from my iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He only wants you to go through a test which will teach you things about yourself, teach you things about Allah and about life, so that you can get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Would Allah, your wakil, give you a test that will make you reject your deen? No. So if you see a calamity befallen on you, and you feel that this calamity is going to destroy my deen, you will panic a lot as a believer. You will only manage to calm down if you have trust in Allah, believing that Allah is very merciful to me. He is not going to send towards me something that will destroy my akhirah. He will only send me a trial that is sufficient for me to learn something about my deen, to learn something about Allah, to learn something about myself, to learn something about people, about life. I'm going to learn something through this trial, something that I could never learn theoretically through the Quran and the Hadith. Maybe I needed practical lessons for me to learn it. So this is the only purpose of the trial. So when you are hit with the trial, don't make the trial shake your confidence in Allah. Keep the confidence. And like I said before, I have seen people, the minute they are hit with trials, immediately they fear for their akhirah. They say, that's it. I don't think I can manage this. I don't think I can cope with this. And because this is what they are saying, they fail the test. But if they said, no, Allah isn't going to let me down. If Allah sent this to me, I can do it. And with this energy, they face any trial they have in their lives. Also, there's a story of this lady that one of the Sahaba came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He came to Medina and he said, after we finished our business, I decided that I am going to go to this man, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I'm going to listen to what he had to say, and I'm going to relate and convey whatever he says to my people, back to my people, to his tribe. And then he said, when I met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave me da'wah and he pointed at one of the houses in Medina, and he said, this is the house of a lady that went out in an expedition with one of the armies of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she left behind her وَتَرَكَتْ ثِنْتَيْ عَشْرَةَ عَنْزًا لَهَا وَصِيصَتَهَا. The Prophet said that she went out with this army and she left behind her 12 sheep, and she used to use them to weave wool and sell from the wool. When she came back, one of her sheep was lost. And she kept on insisting on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She said, oh Allah, you promised that whoever goes out on your path, you will protect their property. And there are many hadith of this meaning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises anybody who goes on the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether it is da'wah, whether it is jihad, Allah will protect their property. So he said, because you promised that, I know that my sheep is going to come back to me. And he said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she insisted on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She asked him so strongly, فَأَصْبَحَتْ عَنْزُهَا وَمِثْلَهَا وَصِيصَتَهَا وَمِثْلَهَا. He said that on the next day, she got up and she had, instead of 12, 24 of her goats and sheep. 24. And every one of them, she had that weaving tool that she used to use for weaving wool. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, وَهَاتِيكَ. Here is the lady. Go and ask her if you wish. So this is a real story that happened in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and he used to use it as evidence that whoever put his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this lady, he said, oh Allah, you promised that if I put my trust in you, you will not let me down. And like so with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to her. The story of the black lady, قصة المرأة السوداء. This is a lady that came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, This hadith is narrated in Bukhari and Muslim by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma. He said, I said to Ata, one of the Tabi'een, I said to him, Ata, do you want me to show you a lady who walks the surface of this earth and we know that she's in Jannah? Ata said, where she is? He said, that black lady over there. He pointed at a black lady and he said, that lady is of the people of Jannah. And he said, shall I tell you how? He said, yes. He said, this black lady came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and she said to him, O Prophet of Allah, I have fits. I have seizures, brain seizures, in which I fall down and I lose consciousness. She said, O Prophet of Allah, this calamity has affected my life severely. Can you make dua that Allah would relieve me from this calamity? The Prophet ﷺ said, In shi'ti da'awtu Allah an yu'afiyaki. Wa in shi'ti fasbiri wa laki al-jannah. He said, if you want, I can make dua and Allah will relieve you of this and He will give you your health back. But if you want, you could also be patient and tolerate the qadr of Allah and Allah will give you jannah. She said, no, I would rather be patient. I will display patience in this and I want Jannah in return. She said, O Prophet of Allah, but when I go through these seizures, I reveal myself. O Prophet of Allah, make dua that when I have these fits, my awrah doesn't show. So he made dua for her that when she has the fits, she will not reveal herself. And that exactly happened. So from that point onwards, the Sahaba, they used to know her that the lady from Jannah. So what we learn from this hadith that if you want, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He could relieve you from all your difficulties. But how are you going to get to Jannah? If you tolerate the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the rida, you remember the third station of tawakkul is what? Rida, to be content and happy. And to rejoice over the calamity like you rejoice over the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he said to her, if you want, I could ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to relieve you from this calamity, but realize that you are missing out on an opportunity to go to Jannah. So if Jannah needs a price, and if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends you a calamity, what is He giving you? He's giving you an opportunity for Jannah. So you ask Allah, oh Allah, give me Jannah, oh Allah, give me Jannah. You know what you're asking for? A little bit of hardships and a little bit of tribulation. So when Allah answers your prayers and give you what you want, you say, oh Allah, relief, relief, relief. You know? What about patience? How are you going to get to Jannah? Huh? Ah, barakallah feek. Yutahhirak, to purify you, to lift your rank in Jannah. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He wants best for you, when He decrees some calamity or some hardship for you, He's only doing that for your own good. And you need to realize, and this is story number 10, I believe, that if you are meant to die, or if any hardship or any pain or hurt is meant to afflict you, it's going to come to you. And nothing can avoid it. So you might as well become confident. March this dunya with confidence. Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu an, he said, by Allah, I have witnessed and I have been involved in 100 battlefields. 100 battlefields. Perhaps more, even more than 100. He said, لَقَدْ شَهِدْتُ مِئَةَ زَحْفٍ أَوْ زُهَاءَهَا وَمَا فِي بَدَّنِي مَوْضِعُ شِبْرٍ إِلَّا وَفِيهِ ضَرْبَةٌ بِسَيْفٍ أَوْ رَمْيَةٌ بِسَهَمٍ أَوْ طَعْنَةٌ بِرُمْحٍ. He said, there is no handspan in my body except that there is a mark of a hit by a sword or a spear or an arrow or some sort of mark in my body. But none of these caused my death. He's saying these words in the moment of his death. And look at me, I am dying like a camel on my own bed. So you think that a person that goes through 100 and more than 100 battlefields, you would think, subhanAllah, one of them could have caused his death. But if death isn't supposed to come, it's not going to come. So put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, Shaykh al-Islam al-Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi, he narrates in his book Al-Fatawa Al-Kubra. He said that Ali radiallahu anhu, when he faced the revolution by Al-Khawarij on his time, Al-Khawarij basically what they used to believe that Iman is either on or off. You either have it or you don't have it. If you commit any sin, this is not an indication that you are a person who has weak Iman, but rather it's an indication that you are kafir altogether. You have any sin in your life, you are a kafir person. So they used to kill Muslims. These are called Al-Khawarij. So Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu an, he was fighting them. So one time he went to fight Al-Khawarij. He met a fortune teller on the way, Munajjim or Kahan. He said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, la tusafir fa'inna al-qamara fil aqrab. He said, oh, leader of the believers, do not travel now because the moon is on the aqrab. You know, they have certain locations in the heavens. So if the moon matches a certain location, they say this is evil sign. This is a bad omen. So don't go now. Wait until the moon moves some other days, then you can go out. Ali ibn Abi Talib, only to defy him, he said, no, I'm going now. To defy the fortune teller. He went out and he defeated Al-Khawarij. And he came back and he was joyful for the victory and for the fact that he was able to defy the fortune teller. Two stories can be a little bit controversial for somebody who doesn't understand tawakkul. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith concerning a person who have leprosy. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La adwa, wa la tiyara, wa la safar." La adwa, no contagion. Some sicknesses are contagious; they pass from one person to another. This is called adwa. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "La adwa, no contagion." La adwa. And then he says, "Wala tiyara," meaning that don't believe on superstition. Remember the tayr we said before? When they release a tayr, if it goes left, they think it's a bad omen. If it goes right, they believe it's a good omen. La adwa, no contingency. And la tiyara, no superstition. Wala safar. Safar is a month the Arabs they used to believe an evil month. So they don't like to do anything serious in that month. They don't go through wars, they don't do anything in that month. They think it's evil. And then the Prophet ﷺ says, وَفُرَّ مِنَ الْمَجْذُومِ فِرَارَكَ مِنَ الْأَسَدِ. And he said, and run away from the lepers, from a person with leprosy, like he would run away from a lion. You know, leprosy is contagious. If you come in direct contact with a person who has that sickness, it will come to you. So in the beginning of the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, لا عدوى, no contagion. And at the same time, at the end, he says, فُرَّ مِنَ الْمَجْذُومِ, run away from a person with leprosy, run away from them, like he would run away from the lion. So how could we reconcile? What does it? Huh? No, when the Prophet says la adwa, no contingency, what does that mean? There is a contingency, something that we see in our daily life. But what the Prophet meant by saying there is no contingency, he means that no adwa would work by itself in isolation from the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So adwa could affect you if Allah allows it to affect you. Adwa could affect you if Allah decreed that it will affect you. But in the other hand, in your part, you should say, I will do isti'ana. I will seek Allah's help by making sure that I don't allow this disease to come to me. And that's why you should run away from the person with leprosy. Run away from them. Like how you would run away from the lion. Now the story that's a little bit controversial is the story of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anh. It was reported that Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anh, he met a person with leprosy and he sat down with him and he ate. He ate with the man of leprosy. So this seems to be defying to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that run away from a man with leprosy and Umar radiallahu anh is sitting with him. So Umar radiallahu anh, he has tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which meant that he believed that leprosy by itself will never affect you. And that's exactly what the Prophet wanted to say. He wanted people to believe that the natural causes of any evil, they don't work in isolation from the decree of Allah. Very important aspect that we need to believe in. If something is not meant to cause your death, it will not cause your death. If something is meant to cause your death, it will cause your death. So even if you have all the evil causes around you, you will not die unless Allah decrees that. So Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, because he wanted to affirm this, he sat down and he ate with a person with leprosy. Okay? Just to prove the point. And obviously, the scholars, they said, if you are a person with iman like Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, that tawakkul will become sufficient in protecting you. Tawakkul is a cause for protection. Remember we said this yesterday? And it will be a good enough cause that will give you protection. However, they said that this is not the case that should be followed by the masses, the ordinary people. When you see a man with leprosy, run away, like the Prophet suggested. So you don't believe that sickness will come to you only because of contingency. You believe that contingency work, if it's allowed and permitted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second story is the story of Khalid ibn al-Walid radiallahu anhu. When he went to Al-Hira, this is a city in Iraq, near Persia. when they were preparing themselves to have fight with the non-Muslims. They said to him, احذر السم لا يسقيكه الأعاجم. They said, oh Khalid ibn Walid, be careful, because these A'ajim, these disbelievers, these non-Arabs, they are known to feed their enemies poison. He said, bring me the poison, I will drink the poison. And he did. He did drink the poison, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected him. So now, you would think that following the causes of protection would entail that you will avoid drinking poison. Why did Khalid ibn Walid drink it? The answer, they said, again, they said, this is not for the masses to follow. You should run away from drinking poison. You should protect yourself from poison. Because they said, first and foremost, there's a possibility that this is a karama, a miracle for Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anh. There's that possibility. And they said, there's also a possibility that Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anh, he was told by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he has this karama. So because of his confidence in the promise of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he knew that the poison isn't going to affect him. So this is something that is true for Khalid ibn Walid, but it's not true for us. So they said, because of these possibilities, laymen or ordinary people, they should not follow the example of Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anhu. There are many examples, my brothers and sisters, for tawakkul. And you remember yesterday we said, tawakkul is the only reason through which people can do amazing things in their lives. Every form of ibadah is only performed because of tawakkul. So if we trace stories that are relating sabr, that are relating steadfastness, that are relating any aspect of the deen, you can find it boiling down to tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? The story of the wife of Fir'aun, the story of Mashitat Fir'aun, the hairdresser of Fir'aun, the way she was killed, how she stood fast. Okay? The story of the man amongst the Sahaba who was killed by the non-Muslims when he was captured. Okay? All the stories of the companions of the Prophet, if you trace them back, you will find them due to tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are just example stories, but ultimately anything you do in the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to be related to tawakkul. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the end of the series to strengthen our tawakkul on Him and to make us amongst those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with tawakkul and manage to get through tawakkul to all aspects of our deen. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillah rabbil alameen wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in wa jazakum Allahu khayran. Before I take questions, I just remind you that from next week, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, the series is going to stop, the actions of the heart. And the next holiday season, Easter, we will have another run of the series and we will take more actions of the heart and we will cover them. In the meantime, we will go back to our aqidah and tafsir classes. Saturday we will have a tafsir class and Sunday we will have an aqidah class. Yes, Abdul Azim.
Yeah, just one question. In the modern age, we're faced by lots of distractions. Mm-hmm. The news, media, on the way to the station, giving out all these different types of magazines. These things can get in the way of your tawakkul. How do you, and it's so, you know, intense, the modern age and what you're faced with. How do you kind of deal with
it? You're saying we are living in a time where we are surrounded by people who don't believe on tawakkul.
Yes,
people are so directed towards materialism and materialistic lifestyle.
Intense, yeah.
Yeah, so it becomes a little bit difficult for you to overcome that and live a life of spirituality. How do you overcome this? And I say always companionship. Companionships and reminders. We cannot do without reminders, wallah. Without reminders, we cannot do it. You know, what we study here on a weekly basis doesn't necessarily have to be news. You know, I'm not going to every day introduce a new concept which you have never heard before. No, maybe most of what I said is something that you already know. Right? But having this refreshed in your head, having this present in your mind, in such a way that it will influence your thinking. You know, we can have information and it will be tucked at the back of our heads, in our memory. But when we think consciously, those information, because they're not present in our heads, they don't influence our decision making. Right? So somebody who knows the fire of hell exists, they sin because the last time they heard about the fire of hell was months or years before. Right? So having them fresh in your head will help you overcome materialism and the life of materialistic people. That's the only way. Companionship and constant reminders. Constant reminders. Right? Okay, we'll stop with this. Bidhana ta'ala. Jazakumullah khair. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.